A portion of this video is sponsored by Constant Contact.
In the 2020 Formula One season, Ferrari finished 6th out of 10th in the Constructors' Championship. Their worst performance in 40 years. According to their own test driver, they had the worst engine on the grid. And that's in part because in 2019, they bent the rules, or as some would say, they cheated. And unfortunately, the FIA struck a confidential deal with Ferrari, so no one really knows how they cheated. Well, today on B2B, we're gonna break down the science on how they cheated, and then look at how Ferrari re-engineered their engine in 2021 to get back to not sucking. Let's go.
Thank you to Constant Contact for sponsoring this portion of this video. As the wise Sean Corey Carter once said, I'm not a businessman, I'm a businessman. And since I'm at the office so much making content for you guys, I realized I needed space here to support my business needs. That's why I secretly built this. While this secret lair allows me to be a better businessman, it's important you guys have support with your small businesses. That's why Constant Contact is a go-to qualified resource for providing small businesses around the world with online marketing tools and personalized coaching to help market and grow your brand. I know a lot of you out there have small businesses like Nolan's Curl Cream for Men or Uncle Jerry's Bird Food, and it's never been more important to stay in touch with your customers, and Constant Contact, they know that. They make online and email marketing a breeze. You can use their email marketing automation to help drive sales and keep your audience engaged while at the same time building an accessible customer contact list. Constant Contact also makes it easy for small businesses to build a custom website with e-commerce functionality. So what are you waiting for, fellow business person? Grow your brand today and head on over to constantcontact.com or click the link in the description to try it for free today. And soon enough, maybe you'll have your own secret office like me. Nolan, what are you doing here?
Jerry, what is this place?
Thanks to Constant Contact for sponsoring that portion of this video.
Ferrari is the most successful Formula One team of all time. They have more pole positions, more Grand Prix wins, and more Constructors' Championship than any other team. So if anyone can come back from a disastrous season, Ferrari can do it. But why do they have to make a comeback at all? What the heck happened to make their 2020 season so terrible? Well, Ferrari's worst season since the disco era actually started in 2019 with a cheating scandal. Ferrari's 2019 car, the SF90, seemed unusually fast, especially at high-speed, power-hungry circuits like Monza and Spa. Now, other F1 teams suspected that Ferrari was making extra power by breaking the rules on fuel delivery. The FIA limits fuel flow rate to 100 kilograms an hour and installs a sensor on each car to monitor this. The sensor, it's called a fuel flow meter, and its job is to do exactly that. Monitor the fuel rate so the FIA can make sure you're not squirting more fuel into the engine than what's allowed by the rules. And this meter is placed between the low pressure pump inside the fuel tank and the high pressure pump mounted on the engine. The fuel flow meters use the ultrasonic time of flight principle to measure the velocity of the fuel flowing through a straight section of fuel line. It starts with a short burst of ultrasound generated by a transducer located at one end of the tube, traveling the same direction of the fuel. A short time later, an identical burst from a transducer at the other end of the tube is sent in the opposite direction against the direction of fluid flow. In one direction, you have the speed of sound plus the speed of the fluid. In the other direction, you have the speed of sound minus the speed of the fluid. A sensor then measures the time it takes that wave of ultrasound to hit the sensor in each of the two directions and subtracts one from the other. This ends up giving a value which is proportional to the velocity of the fuel. And if you know the cross-sectional area of the line, you can calculate the flow rate. And they tie this meter into the car's wiring harness where the data is shared between the team and its ECU and the FIA. But say you want to squirt more juice into your Italian stallion so it'll go faster without this fuel flow meter ratting you out to the FIA. Well, there are a couple ways you can do it. You can either run at max flow rate even when you don't need it and then save that fuel in a separate tank for later use. You cache the fuel upstream of the meter, or you can trick the meter itself. When these fuel meters first hit the scene, there were technical directives and rule changes to prevent teams from doing the first method. But what about option two? get tricky and trick the meter. Now, any sensor that's on an F1 car has a sampling rate, how many times per second a sample is taken. For the fuel flow meters, that rate is 2.2 kilohertz, meaning it takes 2,200 samples every second. We actually plotted that, and this is what it looks like here. Every 0.00045 seconds, we get a piece of data, and the amplitude of that single point of data corresponds to the flow rate. If it's higher than 100 kilograms an hour, then you're busted. But I'm Ferrari, okay, and I need more fuel.
Okay, I need it.
I need that fuel.
So could I hide those pesky peaks that are a telltale sign of me cheating? If you can cheat the test, you can beat the rest. Every MLB player in the 90s, Lance Armstrong. He said it, not me. Now you can hide those peaks in a few ways. You can alter the signal by jamming it or scrambling it so bad that it produces inconsistent and unreliable data, or you can alter the fuel flow itself. The electric pumps in F1 cars don't deliver a constant stream of fuel flow. They're pulsed. It's similar to how a fuel flow meter works. Those points of data dip down and dip back up. They're on-off, and that on-off is super fast. It's 2,200 times a second, but there's still time when it's off. If we were to make a similar graph of the fuel flow from the pump that's pulsing, it creates a graph similar to the waveform of the meter. Now, what if we could phase those pulses of the pump to supply more fuel when the meter is in the off stage? So by the time the meter turns back on, the fuel pulse has dropped back down to its maximum allowed rate, tricking the sensor into thinking that the max flow rate never went beyond 100 kilograms an hour. Remember, the fuel flow meter is tied into the team's ECU, so they can synchronize the sampling rate with the pump's pulse rate, constantly adjusting the pump's output to the meter. Tricky, tricky buff pony boys. Now, I don't know how, but the Red Bull team smelled something fishy over at Ferrari. So doing what Red Bull does best, they designed several possible systems that could fool or bypass the mandatory fuel flow sensor and submitted these designs as request for clarification to the FIA. Their thought was, hey, we got a good idea that they're cheating. So we're gonna show this to the FIA and then ask them if it's allowed. They will then have to make a ruling on it. They're gonna draw a line right in the sand on what is and isn't legal. They snitched, but they snitched in the most nerdy way possible. Now, the FIA responded with several technical directives. These are updates or changes to the technical regulations. That's the main rule book of Formula One. That's what the formula stands for. It was these directives that said the systems Red Bull described were prohibited by the rules around fuel delivery. Any team using these systems would be in violation of Formula One rules. And funny enough, immediately after the directives were released, the Ferrari car got noticeably slower. The FIA launched an investigation into Ferrari, but after several months, they reached an agreement that would remain confidential. This was to protect Ferrari's intellectual property from public release, and in exchange, Ferrari agreed to help the FIA to improve the monitoring of all Formula One power units, as well as assist in the FIA in other regulatory duties. It's like the FBI hiring a hacker, except the hacker is a billion-dollar luxury car company. In total, there were 7 technical directives resulted from the scandal, and these included increased monitoring of the fuel flow and new sensors to monitor energy from the hybrid system. The new rules also limited the maximum amount of oil which could be consumed during racing or present in the intake, in case that's what Ferrari had been doing. Small amount of oil in the intake of most turbocharged engines is normal because oil is used to cool the turbo. But one of the proposed theories about Ferrari's extra power was that they engineered a controlled oil leak at their intercooler. The flammable oil provided a little boost of extra fuel when it reached the engine. This was now also explicitly illegal. But come on, this is an Italian car. Sure, there was an engineered oil leak. It's supposed to be that way. Nobody knows for sure if any or all of those technical directives forced changes that affected Ferrari's power output. But what we do know is that their power was affected for 2020. In preseason testing, the SF90's replacement, the SF1000, was nearly a second slower per lap than the previous year's car, meaning it had an estimated loss of about 65 horsepower. That power loss was bad, but the main issue slowing the car seemed to be the relationship between the engine and the car's aerodynamics. The 2020 bodywork had been designed around the previous more powerful engine. The revised, less powerful engine couldn't overcome the drag from that bodywork. Ferrari was left struggling throughout the 2020 season, unable to find the right configuration for the SF1000 within the allowable adjustments. But in the break between 2020 and 2021, Ferrari engineers, They got to work. They extracted more power out of their SF1000's engine, or more specifically, its power unit. An F1 power unit, or PU, is a hybrid system using a 1.6 liter turbocharged gas engine and two electric motor generator units, or MGUs. The MGUH recovers heat from the exhaust and uses that energy to spin the turbo, reducing lag. The MGUK, which used to be called KERS, recovers kinetic energy from braking. It's connected to the gasoline engine's drive shaft and supplements the power going to the wheel. A complex system like an F1 power unit must be engineered so that everything works together in harmony. And if you change one thing, then the whole system suffers. So hypothetically, let's say you raise the total fuel flow above 100 kilograms an hour, the maximum allowed by the FIA. Then you would have to change other parts of that power unit to make use of that extra fuel. If you didn't take away that extra fuel, the power unit wouldn't work properly as a system and would make less power as a whole unit. The biggest change they made this year was using the superfast head. The superfast head increased air and fuel flow speed, not fuel flow volume, which is what got them in a mess to begin with. That extra speed increases fuel atomization. That means the hydrocarbons in the gasoline and the oxygen molecules in the air are more thoroughly and evenly mixed when they reach the cylinders. Greater atomization leads to faster combustion because the flame can propagate through an even mixture more quickly. The superfast head also increases pressure in the combustion chamber, meaning more fuel and more air get burned, which produces James.
More power, baby!
Of course, to make the superfast head work, Ferrari has to maximize the amount of air getting into the engine. And for that, a lot of attention has been paid to the turbo system. They've revised the compressor and made it smaller to make it easier to spin up. That means the energy from the MGUH is used more efficiently. They've also repositioned the intercooler so that intake air will be colder, making it more dense. Cooler air is more dense, which means you get more of it. Got more air, got more fuel, you got more power. While none of these changes are revolutionary by itself, they add up to an increase of about 20 horsepower. That might not sound like much, but it's a start. Ferrari claims they will put them on par with Renault and the Honda-powered Red Bull. Of course, like we talked about before, once the engine is making more power, there are other parts of the car need to be adjusted to match. Now, the development freeze for 2021 didn't include everything, so you can still work on side impact structures, small aerodynamic components like vortex generators, basic suspension components like wishbones, which are control arms, and cooling systems. All those can be altered. So numerous small parts have been changed for the SF21, all in the name of reducing drag and improving aerodynamics overall. One of the main sources of drag in 2020 were the side-mounted radiators. The inlet for these have been narrowed to reduce drag and refined to make better use of incoming air. For anything other than small revisions like these, the FIA introduced a token system. Each team, they get two tokens to spend on specific parts of the car, which they are then permitted to redesign. Different parts have different token costs based on their importance for performance. Single token parts include the clutch, DRS, brakes, and pit stop equipment. If a team wants to alter more significant parts, they have to spend two tokens. For example, they could choose to redesign the inboard suspension components like shocks and springs, or the electrical system, or the driver's cockpit. It's like when you're at Chuck E. Cheese's and you have all your tickets and you go up to the booth and you're like, I can get a pencil eraser or a pack of sweet tarts, or I can just walk behind the counter when you're not there and steal whatever I want. Don't do that! Ferrari has been having significant problems with aerodynamics, so guess what they chose? The gearbox.
Wait, what?
Well, as it turns out, this was actually a genius move. By choosing to modify the gearbox, they're also permitted to redesign sections of the bodywork around it at the rear of the car. That includes rear suspension attachment points, which were altered to move the car rearward. And they did that because they saw success that Mercedes had with that suspension design. Choosing the gearbox meant engineers could sculpt the rear bodywork to minimize drag while maximizing downforce at the rear wing. The FIA implemented mandatory reductions in downforce for 2021, which has slowed every car down on the grid. Every team has been struggling to compensate for that, with teams like AlphaTauri and Alfa Romeo spending their tokens specifically on aerodynamic redesigns. Ferrari's Leclerc had significant trouble specifically with the rear end grip in 2020, and by resculpting just the rear of the car around the gearbox, Ferrari is able to make aerodynamic improvements that affect everything from the rear ring to the passage of air under the floor without specifically spending tokens on aerodynamics. freaking smart, dude. So the million-dollar question is, will it all work? Enrico Gotieri, the director of Ferrari's power unit department, claims the new engine improvements alone are worth a tenth of a second per lap. Binotto is cautiously optimistic, saying that Ferrari needs three or four races to fully understand the true potential of its 2021 Formula car. And I don't want to give you any spoilers, but they're doing pretty good in the season so far. There's only been two races since we've filmed this episode, and they're number four in the standings. Will that change by the time this comes out? I don't know, I don't have a magic ball. In the fifth round this season, Ferrari cars are going to place
second
and
did not start.
At the rate that Ferrari's going, it looks like they're going to have a successful 2021 season, but who knows? Leave a comment down below, let me know if you think Ferrari made a comeback. Did they re-engineer their car better? Did they cheat? Are they cheating in another way? I don't know, maybe they are. Maybe they got us focused on one thing so they can dabble on another part of the car. Put some comments down below, let me know what you think. Thank you guys so much for watching this episode of B2B. Follow us on Instagram @DonutMedia. Follow me @JeremiahBurton. Until next week, bye for now.